Bumps and bruises, scratches and scrapes, some of the ingredients that a good life makes. But sorrows become success. And as we aim for the top, we will pause if we must, but we will never stop. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions, the safe space to share your stories. Tonight, for our season finale, we have reached out to someone you know well, who was here one day, flying high, then she was gone. We saw her on our TV screens, we heard her on our radios. She was at the top of her game, very well, but at the bottom of a hell, she will describe tonight. No, today she is healthy, wealthy, happy, and proud. And here to share her story with us, Denise Ayoka. Should I use Hunt?
Yes.
Denise Hunt Ayoka is in our big chair tonight, and we have so much to catch up on that we're not even going to do a check through with anybody else. We're going to get right to it. Mm-hmm. Hello, Denise.
Simone.
If I'm glad to see you one
if
more time.
I happy to see you here in this space one more time.
I know.
It is a joy.
Thank you.
To see you owning this. And to see you bringing the stories, a joy. I love it. And I'm proud of you.
Oh, God bless you. Me proud of you too, and the way you are. You're owning your story. You,
yes, ma'am.
When we spoke, I was riveted. I told you I knew something was going on, but I never really know what it was. Because one day you were here and one day you were gone. And essentially you're saying if you never leave Jamaica, you're just, if you never leave, you couldn't live.
Done. End. End. It was too much. It was too much. I had to go. Like, I couldn't stay here and be alive 10 years later. It's been 10 years since I left. And I just knew. I just... So if we could backtrack a little bit. When I got saved in November of 2012, I knew very, very clearly, without any doubt, that I had to leave the space of Jamaica. Because in my natural, I looked around and I'm like, so where else is there to go? Mm-hmm. Oh, there's nowhere to go. I have a gym, I'm training clients, I'm on TV, I'm on radio. There was the Denise Hunt Hour because I had two programs running back to back. And that didn't fulfill me. It don't fulfill you?
Empty.
Emptiness.
Why, you know, if it's one thing this program going to reinforce for a lot of people is how they see people in the space thriving. Mm-hmm. And inside you are empty. The reservoir is on E. But I'm going to go back to Almonton because that's where it started and where you grew up. And largely, you know, a lot of what you went through later on came out of this one word that you use a lot, which is shame, right?
Yes.
And so you grew up in Almonton. You said about life in Almonton and the fact that you didn't even really know what your situation was till you got to Queens.
Yes.
So let's talk about life in Almonton.
So Almonton is this inner city that government has forgotten existed clearly. We didn't have trash collection, garbage on the streets, gutter water. I always talk about the gutter water in Almonton because that's what I was jumping over, walking through, hop, skipping and jumping to get to Almonton Primary. The school was without resources, and I can say that now because I've been into a space where there were resources. So when I was going to Almonton and either coming first or second in my class and walking through Almonton streets and, good morning, Miss So-and-so, evening, Mr. So-and-so, because I was raised by the village. I had no idea I was poor, Simone. I had no idea I was poor. The only thing I had to contend with was the... Let me find out a delicate way to say this,
because
I'm a good Christian woman now. The only thing I had to contend with was my fear of which other male human was going to have a sexual interest in me at the age of 6 or the age of 7. That's the only thing I had to contend with. I was brilliant in school. I had a lot of energy. I had too much energy. I was the only grandchild or as the only child. And, you know, there was a lot of dynamic. And even though reflectively, you'd think a six-year-old would know if she go to bed and don't have food. She would know that, and she would know she was hungry. I didn't know I was hungry. I didn't know there was something left out of my life, like nutrition. Because that's not something you miss. You don't miss what you don't know, you know. It's not like I had it one day and then I didn't. And so life in Almontown was about my grandmother always cooking Sunday dinner, always, because I grew up with my granny. Always, no, if we don't eat any other day, I knew I was going to have Sunday dinner. And by extension, I knew I'd have Monday dinner, right? Walking to school a lot. There's a lot of walking. I grew up beside a gully bank in Almontown near to Banana Board. I don't even think that exists anymore. So yes, me all. And
bathing outside.
We didn't have running water, so we'd have to catch water at the neighbors who had running water and take it outside toilet, that kind of thing, right? And I remember the home sweet home kerosene lamp, because we'd have to clean the lamp with newspaper, and every time we bathe, and it's real bathing, not a shower or whatever, because you bathe out a pan and dip and so, right? That I would always have to clean my nose and my ears properly. My grandmother would check, you know, let me see, because it's a thing when you have a kerosene lamp, there's a black soot that is always present on your body. Like if you go like this, it will come off on your skin, and people don't know that. I'm like, home sweet home, oh, the nostalgia of old Jamaica. No, it's poor people use lamp. And some of the poor people recognize that using this thing, as innocent and as quaint and as cute as it is in a little board house with zinc fence, it's a thing that you feel when you go to school and know that the other kids didn't have to do that.
Because they had a switch they could flick on and...
And it dead air.
So when you went to Queens now then, and you go to school and you see parents picking up their children and children talking about being around the dinner table to have dinner with their parents, and you're like, wow, their mother and their father live in the same place?
Yes.
They have dinner around it.
A dining table.
Culture shock.
Big culture shock. Well, first of all, back in the day at Queens, a dark-skinned girl was more of an anomaly than it is now. So the girls that went there were light-skinned, uptown, you know, mixed race kind of a thing. And you saw something with somebody that didn't look like you, and you're like, well, it must be because of how I look. Then clearly, because very few dark-skinned girls were being dropped off, very few dark-skinned girls were looking like they had any kind of struggle. I was the only one I knew of who had only two uniforms, because that's all my mother could afford at the time, because by that time I now lived with my mother sometimes, right?
When you were running away to
your
granny.
I was a runaway.
Yeah.
But back in the day, them things never matter, right?
Wow. Two uniforms. Hem with any color thread.
Any color thread, because that's what we had, or what we didn't have, right? I remember burning my uniform. And my mother's like, well, you're going to have to wear it for the next 2 years because there's no money to buy any other uniform. So I went through two school years with a burn in the side of my Queen school uniform that a guy burnt my, like, push him cigarette in my side because I never did that, whatever. I wasn't acting wifely. Just I mind my own business at the bus stop and whatever. And a guy decided, like, hey, you know, you're supposed to be whatever and let off and all this kind of thing. And I remember very clearly him pushing the cigarette in my side, and my uniform saved me. But then I had to go to school every day with that thing in my side, right? And, you know, how you articulate to, like, your rich St. Andrew friends and think this happened. Because, first of all, you have a boyfriend? Ew, oh, my God, you have a boyfriend. No, I didn't have a boyfriend. There's just this guy, right?
Did you have a lot of friends, though, in school?
So there were two sets of things going on. There's a girl at school, Deborah Hickling, was an uptown girl, and she befriended me. She befriended me in a hard way, big. Because she saw a struggle, and Debbie would take me home, uptown, up Poor Pastures. Huge deal, that, you know. She have her own room, she have the one in water, hot water. They cooked like curry goat and white rice with vegetable and them things, and she would always feed me. And then there was another set, the misfits, the outcasts, and there were like three or four of us, and we kind of kept it together and hold it down. And so we would go to Shortwood, I would hang out. And so I felt like there was a two-life thing going on, right? There was, I want to be with Deborah, because Deborah have the nice things and the nice parents. But I feel more like I don't have to hide nothing when we go to Shortwood, when we go to Grand Spen Lane. You know what I mean?
Hold it, lady. Yeah. More with Denise when we come back. All the things we take for granted, right?
Yeah.
I'll be right back. Hi, folks, we are back with Denise. Your culture shock when you go to school, all these ladies you know, smelling so good and looking so good. Hygiene was something you say you never even really...
Yeah. There was a body odor issue when I was young. I remember that. I remember sweet smells. You know? I promised my good friend that I wasn't going to come here and make him make my ball, you know, but... I remember my friends smelling sweet, what we call sweet smells, soft floral smells. I remember that. And I remember going to the Chinese wholesale downtown when I could, when I had the money, when I worked summer jobs at Kingston Bookshop and buying deodorant, thinking deodorant was going to solve it. And deodorant didn't solve it because that's not what my issue was. I developed gynecological issues that impeded me from having children later on in life, that I didn't know I could tell somebody to take me to the doctor, or I have an issue and it need to fix. I didn't know any of those things. And so when you stand up beside somebody with them nice perm hair and you have your cream, you hear yourself, right? Or you hear plait up and you look like what I'm called schoolers, and they had the nice healthy perm and the nice clean uniform without sweat stains, without shredder show. When you're in class beside those people, you're not sitting up front. You're sitting on the back.
Because you're hiding.
Because you're hiding.
Because you're the other.
Yes.
In addition to that, you know, these folks have their mother and fathers together. You're living with your mother by this time, but your dad you did not know.
No.
And you met your father for the first time when he was lying in a casket at his funeral.
You know, or
did you?
You know, when I think I met my father, there are two instances. Before my father died, I always heard about this man, Rusty. That was his name. That's the name that I knew. I always heard about him. I was at home. We were living in Dorney Park at the time. And for us, that was uptown. And I looked around and I saw this man. And he was dressed in a hat and a jacket, dark black or whatever jacket, right? And he walked through the room that my mother lived in into the other side of the house. And I'm like, oh my God, look, there's a man in the house. And there was a lady, my neighbor, older lady, little Indian lady. And she turned and she looked like, look over her shoulder. And she goes, And I'm like, Miss Ling, you see him? And I'm all excited. I think I was about 7. And I remember Miss Ling telling my mother that she described the man. And my mother said, but that sound like Rusty. And she was like, who's Rusty? Denise's father. And she's like, will him come visit her today? And I didn't know the significance of that until he died. And somebody thought it was a good idea to have Rusty children walk past the casket and go say hello and suck because you don't know your father. And I was looking at this pretty brown man in this casket and I was like, yeah, it's kind of my face, but brown. Okay. And I remember just looking at his face, pretty, just pretty, skin beautiful. And one day I was coming from school at Dorney Park Primary. And I remember singing the song, Old Pirates, Yes, They Rob I. I'm singing the song and I'm taking my ruler and I'm hitting the walls. And I felt this presence over me. And may I walk, and may I sing. I'm gonna start bawling for no reason, like I'm just crying, like why am I crying? And what is this presence beside me? And I remember just bawling, like out loud, bawling and just walking through the streets. And I recognized at 12, you don't have a father. You don't have a father. And I didn't recognize the importance of that until I got older and started experiencing bad relationship after bad relationship after awful, just awful, awful relationships. I didn't recognize it. I'm like, how could you not, you know?
So now when you look back, because you said your mother said you were moody.
Oh.
How 1 minute you're on top of the world and then the next minute you were doing exactly what you just
depression,
described. But you
Simone.
Didn't know what it was. It was deep.
Then who, depression. Like who would tell us? Who talked about those things back in the day?
Exactly.
Who sat their 10-year-old or 11-year-old or 12-year-old, who sat them down and say, tell me about what you're feeling because I hit you because whatever. Or tell me about what you were feeling because somebody at school said to you, oh, Denise, you know, you're cute for a dark-skinned girl. Tell us about what you're feeling. Talk to me. Use your words. Nobody did that, Simone. You go to school, you get your A's, and you go home and you go sit down. You don't even get TV time. Go do your homework and go to your bed. There is no conversation. Adults did not pull children in, or adolescents, or teenagers, whatever, in and say, talk now, what's going on? Tell me why that made you so angry, or tell me why you're sleeping for 18 hours of the day, or tell me why you're not eating. They don't. And parents weren't seeing, adults weren't seeing these signs of classic depression in a 10-year-old, an 8-year-old, an 11-year-old, a 12-year-old.
But they probably, your mom wouldn't have been able to identify it either.
Poor thing. She was going through her own struggles. She was going through her struggles because my mother was a hustler, you know. And it's one thing she going to feed her, picnic them.
Yep.
She going to feed us.
Yep. You ended up at 12 being a mother figure to your, to your younger sister.
Yes.
Whom you eventually, when you went on your own, you took her with you. Because you said that's an unwritten rule in the inner city.
Yes.
Right? When you grow old enough, you take your sibling, if you have any, and you go and make better life.
Yeah.
Speaking of better life, you got an opportunity to study. A scholarship to study at Edna. We're going to tell you what happened with that. When we come back, more with Denise on the other side.
Yeah.
Soon call. Yes, ma'am. Back with Denise Hunt, you probably haven't seen in a long time. She's catching us up on why she left here so quickly and where she's been and what she's been up to. We're at the point now where you get your scholarship to Edna and you go to mommy and you're excited.
Yes.
Because otherwise, without scholarship, you cannot go
can't
to university.
It. Where the money going to come from?
What does mommy say to you?
So Keith Parkin, bursar and acting director at the Queen's School at the time, got me a scholarship at Edna Manley. And because I was the biggest thing on high school stage at the time. And my mother said, then how long that going to take? And I said, it's a 4-year scholarship. 4 years? But then I mean, I think you're going to leave high school and graduate and you're going to get to a little work and come help you out. And that was the end of that, you know.
Just like that, Denise.
Because here's the thing, and I know the heart of my mother. I don't think she was being wicked and bad and awful and selfish. It is just I was stepping out of the norm. I'm the eldest. I'm supposed to get myself in, get my subjects, which I did, and go get one work. Continue at Kingston Bookshop if that opportunity was there, and start to help, you know, pay some bills and supplement her income. Right? Because my mother was an unmarried woman who she had hustled on her own as a single mother, she doing her thing. But she needed help. Mm-hmm. And so it was, how are we going to protect the species? This is us 3 girls. We got to do this, right? Years later, of course, I resented it. Mm-hmm. I resented it so much because I felt like I should have gone to acting school. I would have been the biggest thing. I would have been in Hollywood, blah, blah, blah. But God has a way of bringing the story back around, right? And so even though I lost that opportunity, I had great, amazing acting opportunity on stage and in film, right?
Yeah.
So it did work out all right.
Let's talk about
Stella got her groove back.
Minor matters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But then also the opportunities you got while you were here in television.
Yes.
So at 24, you had your son.
Yes.
And you said it was at that time that you were able to put a D word on what it is that you were feeling.
Yes.
Because Denise, at this time now, things start to come around and you're on ER and you're on Rising Stars and you are Denise Hunt on radio.
Yep.
Denise, you were, while you are at the top of your game, you are spending hours on the floor at your home.
Bawling in my own vomit. Isn't that ridiculous?
Simone,
look at me. I look like somebody. I look like somebody who drink till them drunk and throw up. I look like that person to you. Oops. I look like that person to you. Of course not. There were days, you see. And let me just tell people now. So that we can understand that in order for you to reach a state of healed and staying in the state of heal and health, you have to go through it. But you also have to acknowledge that there's a it. And the day my son crawled on the bed, might have been 3 years old, and I was laying there in the bed, the helper came and went, day after day, came and went. And my son is half looking after himself at 3 years old. And I remember Miss Olive was the lady that used to come in and help me when I had my son. And the day the baby crawled in the bed and said, "Mommy, what's wrong?" And I'm like, "Mommy's sick. Mommy's sick."
And he said, "You want juice?" My baby walked to the kitchen and climbed up on the kitchen counter to the top cupboards and got his juice and bring to me and said, "Drink, mommy. Drink, mommy, to make your tummy feel better." That's all he knew. At 3 years old, he's looking after me because I can't open my mouth and tell him. The sick that I feel is like I can't fix. I couldn't get out of the bed for days. I didn't shower for days. My helper, poor thing, she was like, "You want some food, she cook, whatever." I couldn't eat for days. For days. And I recognized, as a good mother, that I wasn't honoring my son. My son is the most important thing to me, Simone. There's nobody before my son. And I'm like, how am I being a mother and letting my son see this, and I'm not handling it, and he's looking after me at 3 years old? You'd have to fix. And so that's when I decided I was going into therapy. I don't remember this lady name right now. Her first name was Sharon. She was a person of faith. And I started counseling with her, did some counseling with some pastors. And every time I walk into a wall, and the wall would look like, "Denise, you have to confront this, you have to deal with this." And that's what therapists are there for. Let me tell you something, guys. Anybody that is not taking advantage of a professional therapist, you're wasting your life. Like, it is the best thing since bully beef and white rice.
Save your life.
You have to. Save my life.
Talk you out of suicide.
It talked me out of suicide. Because what was the point of living? The most important role in my life at the time was being a mother. And I was failing so badly, the roles had reversed because my child was parenting me.
What did you say the only thought was that stopped you?
That he would find me. That the person that's going to find my body is my son. And the pride would have killed me. The shame alone of that thought would kill me. I would never. And years later, having gone through it and having done the work, because healing, hear me, people, healing takes work. And you can't lazy out your life. You cannot lazy out your life and say, "We're just having a bad day." You're not having a bad day. There's a chemical imbalance that is caused by many, many things. There is work that you can do. There's stuff
hard
that
work,
is okay.
But it's necessary work.
It is okay. Hard work is okay. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of us are clocking in 9 to 5 doing hard work with no reward or minimal reward that is not helping them to health or healing.
And not investing in ourselves to make ourselves better.
Because we lie.
To ourselves.
We lie to ourselves and our children. I would not to do
it. But the children know, you know.
If the children know, my son called me about 3 months ago. I said, "Mommy, what did happen that night when so-and-so you put me out of the house?" My son must have been like 7.
And they don't forget.
Postpartum depression. And we had a conversation about it. And it wrecked me for a week. My son in his 20s now, you know. Wrecked me, Simone, years later. Because he had that memory. And because I gave him that memory. Because I had a disease that I didn't catch early enough. And say, "No, man, we're going to do this thing." And the healing for me didn't come until I said yes to Jesus in 2012.
Talk about that on the other side. More with Denise after this. Back with Denise. When you said to me, you know, when you think about your life back then, you wonder, how did this girl get away with it? You know, there are days when we would see you on air and you said you would be barely sober.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know how you string like words together.
My good like goal. You see people... Simone, you see people that are ill, you see mental illness. I challenge you right now that if you walked outside, well, maybe not TBJ, because TBJ is a pure building, you would walk up 10 people on the street, and I guarantee you 6 of them suffering from some kind of mental disease. And I don't mean, oh, them sad and them have bad days and all that kind of thing. I mean mental disease. There'd be days, yes, corporate sponsors, there would be days when you paid me oodles of money and I'd be on this very, not this stage, but this space, and I'd have the worst hangover. Or I would leave this stage and go home and give myself the worst hangover.
But you were functional.
I was so highly functional.
because of the amazing gift that God gave me to just be like this, right? I remember I developed a health issue. And I'm gonna tell you right now, I was bleeding, and the bleeding couldn't stop. It wouldn't stop. It wouldn't go away. And I literally, Sharon Schroeter and Natalie Pabursing are holding me up together. We're in the makeup room. And Sharon said, Denise, she hold my hand. So she said, Denise, tell me now, because I'm gonna call this show. It was a Friday night. On Rising Stars. And she said, I'm gonna call the show. I said, no. I'm standing up and there's blood flowing out of my body. Nothing could stop it. I am having dizzy spells. I can see nothing because I abused my body so much with the alcohol.
Vodka, that
the
vodka.
Body just, vodka is so good. No, it's not. And my body just pop. It just pop. And I couldn't stop this bleeding. And they're like, we have to get her to the hospital now. We have to go. And I'm like, we're going to do the show. Sharon, I promise you, I will go to the hospital after the show. That scared the living daylight out of me because not only was I in immense pain physically, there were things happening that were now on the outside of my body that I couldn't control and I couldn't fake. Right?
But not only that, miss, in addition to all of the abuse you were abusing yourself, you were also being abused in your relationship.
Yes, ma'am.
Proper
yes,
beat
ma'am.
Up and bruise up.
Beat up and black eye and the whole of it, yes, ma'am.
So enough time you come on your makeup?
Yes.
Because
yes. I'm sure the makeup artists are so clever.
Denise, honestly.
Honestly.
You go hotel?
Yes.
With your significant other?
And got the beat out of me. I remember, I go to this particular resort. And I don't know what to do. Like, listen to me, ladies. Women who are in abusive relationships. There is nothing you can do to stop an abuser from abusing you. There's nothing you can do to earn the abuse. There is nothing. It is not you. It is the abuser's issue and not yours. So no matter how... I'm the perfect girlfriend, Nina Simone. I was. I'm the perfect wife now. can you imagine me not being a perfect girlfriend?
No.
Cook for my man, make sure I'm ready, my body look good, all these things. I'm perfect. Why would I be hit? Why would somebody look at me and take an iron and try to bust my face with it open? Good thing me little and good thing me could have moved fast. The manager of the hotel called me, I remember. He said, Miss Denise, are you okay? Yes! Yes, I'm great! Miss Denise, I'm so-and-so-and-so-and-so. I manage this hotel and I'm responsible for all my guests. Miss Denise, are you okay? I'm great. And that whole conversation with that guy is synonymous with how I dealt with that season. Everything is great, everything is good, because I was so highly functional. And I didn't get depressed about the thing during the thing. I would take my licks, go into a corner. Some days I couldn't turn up for work, and the people I worked with understood. And one day my friend Deborah Hickling come to me and said, and for those of you out there who don't have friends like Deborah Hickling and Janet Gibson,
get yourself one.
Get yourself some friends who know you from your 11, who love you without judgment. And Deborah said to me, if you don't leave this man, you're going to die. And my death by an abuser's hand didn't scare me. What scared me was the shame of my friends coming together to stage an intervention. And I suck on my walkway. I can handle getting hit. It's not a big deal. That's a disease, by the way. It's not a big deal. What scared me was the fact that Deborah said she was gonna go to my best friend and she was gonna go to two other people who were close to me and they were gonna come to my home and there'd be an intervention because they were not gonna watch me die. You understand what I'm saying?
Well, you had walked away several times from
a million times before.
But this time you were. So what was it about this time? Was it Deb? And your friends, but what was it about this time that made you decide, I'm not doing this anymore?
Too many people knew.
Okay. Wow.
So I'm not to do it, Nina.
The shame.
The shame, Simone. And plus, he had threatened so many times he was going to let people know blah, blah, blah about me, and I was nothing from nowhere. Too many people knew.
So when you said you were going to walk away, he said to you, but you're not nobody.
Yeah, where are you going to go?
Where are you going to go? When people figure out that you are Denise,
you know, leave me knees.
And you're a drink, and you're. Yeah. You're not nobody.
And you're this. And you're a S word. Like. And you believe that, you know, Simone. You believe it. Because remember, whatever you're experiencing in this now, this is not even the thing that is important, you know. It's the thing that was happening when I was 7. That transitioned itself and brought itself forward into the now. Because going through that from that time told me that this is it. This is a truth. Not the reality is not false. It's truth in my mind, right?
So unresolved issues from then.
Yes, ma'am.
Which is another important point. We got to deal with our stuff because it comes. Until you deal with it, it's going to be with you.
And don't and quit this acting thing. Let me tell you something. Quit this acting thing. I don't care what your job is. I don't care who you aligned with. I don't care how much member of parliament or how many big friends you have. Quit this acting thing. Your life is not a stage. No matter what the poets say, your life is a unique gift given to you for purpose. There are some big things you're supposed to do with your life. And if you have a man beating you every day, if you stay in broke, if you're hitting your children or if you're treating your children poorly or you're in some dead-end job that you know you don't want and don't value you and you don't value it, you have a responsibility to gift back your life the gift of living. Like you just can't stay there. Sure, it done gone bad already. If I tell you how I hate that phrase.
It done gone bad
it
already.
It done gone bad already. I hate it. It's a cop-out. And it says to you, you don't have to do the work. Yes, do the work. You know why you should do the work? Because there's a greater self. And there is more. When you lie down in your bed at 2 o'clock and you go, I should have, I could have. I really want to do this thing. And you don't. That is the thing. That is the truth. That is telling you that you should do the work. Because you can't get to the what you really want to do and who you really want to be without the work.
So the work was what allowed you to rid yourself of the shame.
All of
because
it.
Your word to me is, once you get out in front of that shame, nobody, nothing can stop you.
Yes. So the first thing I did is I opened my mouth and I say it. Then you have a problem, you know.
But management. Remember,
yes. Because remember, I'd been doing therapy, you know. Mm. But all them I do in the hour I'm with you, making me feel better and just explaining away my actions. There's no, make me excise out the devil. Work. The work looks like going on your knees and saying, God, I know that I am your child. Tell me what I need to learn. Let me learn it so I can move on. I want to learn it. And then you call your friends. And he said, this is happening and I cannot walk this. I can't walk it. And your friend will say to you, yes, you can. And pray over you like every angel up in a high. Pray over you. Yes, you can. Because God has declared that you are. And so it no matter who, from where, it no matter what their position is, it matters not what they say. Because God has already declared. And so who you think you are to take away what God has created and say, I'm just going to let it die. Do you know how many people have helped because I've done the hard work? When in Texas, I have locked myself away and gone on my knees and my husband is in the house. I hear me, I shell it down in there. Because prayer is the only way I know to remove the devil from off my heels. Hmm. You don't do the work and stop, you know, Simone?
You can't.
Because we're brilliant people and we have minds and we have brains. And the devil loves to use your backstory and bring forward in front of you. So now when I wake up, I let it know, every enemy know, that I'm here and there's nothing you can do. Like, there's nothing. I'm like, is that the best you've got?
No condemnation.
No, ma'am.
We're going to explore
no,
that.
No, ma'am.
Denise speaks a lot about it. I have goosebumps all over my body. Hey, okay. Let's do it, Lori. We can have an introduction. Go on, run it.
Hey, my Denise. Listen. Tonight, we give you your rose, my sister. Well-deserving. We started our friendship right here in the studio just by holding a flex. And from holding that flex, you became my sister and I became your brother. You have shown me that, listen, blood does not make one a family. And wherever you go and whatever you do, you create families and tribes that have your back without you even knowing. So every single petal from these roses, you deserve it. Big up yourself, my sister. One love.
Oh my gosh, from the first day I met you, you won my heart. You had such a winning smile a great personality. You had a lot of energy. But I'm so happy that we have been friends all these years. I just love your personality. Denise, I'm also so proud of all your achievements. So God bless you. Continue to be the lovable person that you are. Love you lots. Lots of kisses.
You know, it was about 5 years ago that God brought us together as three very, very different women with very different walks in life. And we feel very blessed to have such a real, authentic relationship with you based on truth and love. Some things that we so admire about you is your wisdom and your joy and how encouraging you always are to us. Your passion and your belief in everything that you put your mind to. And it's so true, a cord of three strands is not easily broken, and that's how we feel about our friendship with you. What a blessing. We love you. We love you.
I am so grateful, my friend, to be a witness and participant on your journey. I am truly grateful to have you as a friend, and I just want to tell you how much I love you. I love you, Sutil. I am grateful that for the day that you have entered my life. I am so proud for the leaps and bounds that you have made, and I'm excited for this metamorphosis stage of your life, and to be able to be a part of that and to witness that and to celebrate that, because you are amazing. And I am so thankful that you're a part of my life and I'm a part of yours. Continue doing great things, my friend. I am beyond proud and I love you.
I am incredibly proud of you. I'm incredibly honored and humbled to call you friend and to be called your friend. I can't wait to see what the next 39 years have in store for us. It has been a long ride, and I can only imagine what great adventures are in store for us. So take care, my friend. I love you.
Thank you for being such an amazing big sister, Denise. You have motivated and inspired me to be the best version of myself. I am so proud of you. I love you so much. I'm so happy that I have you to look up to.
But I wish everybody got to know the version of you that we know and love. You have been such an amazing human being, and I'm so happy to be doing this journey called life with you. You're part of the reason why I am where I am today, because you're such an inspiration, and I've watched you over the years as you've grown and morphed into this just absolutely amazing human being and do things that some of us thought was literally impossible. And then you also took on this role in my life as auntie. And we lovingly call you Grampy because you're grandma auntie to my child. You've just been so, 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 so wonderful. And I'm just absolutely overjoyed and feel blessed to have you as a part of my life.
Denise, we've grown up together from teenage insecurities, fears, issues, and triumphs to adult ones. And in a world of debilitating judgment, we have never known that from each other. Where there were limited expectations, we kindled each other's light and stoked each other's fire. Through theater, media, life, you supported, celebrated, and pushed me. And I, you, would drape up each other when it's needed, but the understanding, compassion, and loving embrace of friendship is never far behind. Ours is a seeing and knowing friendship, deep, like the saying, just see and know. And because I see you, and because I know you, this friend has watched you shine, Denise Hunt. I've seen you sizzle, and I could not be more proud of you. You found love, Denise Hunt Mixell. You found light, and because I know the journey, for me, what is best of all is that you found them within you. Bless you, my twin. Always, always blessings, always and forever.
My sister from another mother, who I love so much. We met as teenagers 100 years ago. We were both in high school, and we met and we have remained good, solid friends over these years, weathering the storms together. And yes, we have more places to go and more growth to grow, But I want to tell you how proud I am of who you are becoming, a strong, fierce woman of God, working hard, filled with good, strong ambition and desires to grow. May God continue to bless you, to bless the desires of your heart. May He continue to expand your horizons, and may you remain steadfast in His will. Here's to you, my sister friend. Hugs and love.
I was told to say I love you. I'm just kidding. I don't need to be told to say that to let you know. I do love you. You know, I'm your one and only son, so I feel extra special. I'm your only son, right? I'm just kidding, I know. I'm your only one. But listen, besides the point, Mom, you're awesome. You are fantastic, you know. You raised me. Like me. You know what I'm saying? Like, that speaks volumes. Most people, like, get to raise normal children. You had to raise me. Goodness gracious. More power to you, Mom. And, yeah. I know you're gonna do one of those, like, very forceful laughs when you see this. I always love your laugh, but I'm out of time, so bye.
I always knew you would be an extraordinary woman because you were always an extraordinary child. You were different. You wouldn't go out to play. You would prefer to be inside reading a book than to go outside and play. So I knew that when you became an adult and you became a woman, you would be an extraordinary woman. And I am so, so very proud of you, of the woman that you have become and the woman you continue to be. Extraordinary, talented, gifted. I cannot find enough adjective to describe you right now, but I am so very proud of you as your mom. And I was blessed to have you as my child.
I'm sure you're having a wonderful time in your homeland. I miss you, and I can't wait till you get home, but I know that you're going and eating all that wonderful food you're telling me about and going to all the places and hanging out with your friends that you haven't seen for a while. And I'm sure there's going to be new people that you meet along the way, and they need to know a little bit more about you. What an amazing lady you are. Beautiful inside and out, obviously. And what a very warm heart and caring heart that you have. You reach out through your ministries of Sizzling Seniors, Random Thoughts Live, and Prayer Partners to take care of people, whether you know them or not. And that's something that they should know about you. And I will look to see you back home soon. I love you. You are my heart's desire, always and forever.
Yeah.
Waiting a month? So where am I? What's happening?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, Denise, it's a long time. I don't go on this show.
Oh, Jesus.
Someone mush me up.
Someone you asked him up. To marry you.
I asked him to marry
you. You asked him to marry you.
This guy was, he's so shy, and he's just like this real humble guy, and he works like a Hebrew slave. I remember he had on a Hawaiian shirt. I hate Hawaiian shirts. And the guy dig him to another door, and he's like, well, you know, I just thought I would ask. Well, you know, but if you don't, it's like, I'd like it to like 10 minutes to ask me, would you have dinner with me? I'm like, what? And we would talk, you know? And I brought him back into the faith because he has gone through some things, and he kind of said, I'm just going to do life alone. And we faith talked 2 a.m. This guy don't talk more than 10 words a week, you know. And we would talk in the morning. And then when I bought my house, he celebrated me, you know, Simone. The brother just, he never left my side. And I'll tell you this right now. My pastor will see this years later and say, really? Me and David was going to get in trouble. Because sooner or later, we'd have to stand before pastor, and pastor going to say, so, is there sex? And my pastor says, sex is not important. Sex is not the important thing. But if there is no sex, it becomes important. So, yeah. And I'm like, we need to get married quickly.
Yeah.
That was my response to the question.
Was there.
It was right there. It was like right at my heel.
Yeah, all right.
One day we're hanging out, and I just said, let's elope. And him turned pink.
That was a yes. Yeah. I love love. We're going to take a break. So she said God told her she would leave. She did. She said God had told her she was going to marry a white man, and she did. When we come back, we're going to put a lid on all this with Denise. Any regrets? Is the shame gone? What does the road ahead look like? We'll be right back. Back to Lady with Denise. She talked about the whole live show, so I forgot to rush that part here. No, safe of she. Lady, you left here. You wanted to be anonymous. You left here to be Jane Smith,
yes,
you
ma'am.
Said.
Yeah.
Nobody know you. You can do what you want. And you were happy to shrink into that space called Texas.
Yes.
Until a friend called you out and said, this is not who you are.
Yes.
So you certified yourself as a life coach.
I did.
You're still fitness coaching.
Yes.
And you're now pouring into other people through a gift you say you never even knew you had.
Yeah.
And the small impact you think you could make and the huge impact that your little things do on other people. Then for all the people who are lost, who are shame-filled, who are suffering from abuse, who can't see the next step, who are going through what you've gone through. I'm giving you the next 2 minutes to pour into them before the affirmation.
First of all, I need you to hear this. That before you were born, the God who created you knew you. And he created you with a special set of skills and gifts and talent. And he created you with a protective spirit that would ensure that you own those gifts. So if you're living your life in a way that somebody else is taking advantage of you, or you spend your days crying, or you spend your days in more sadness than joy, or you spend your days locked up in a room, or you spend your days in front of a TV, or you spend your days struggling. If you're doing that, you're not honoring the gift. You have something that somebody else wants. And if you don't rise out in healing, you're depriving somebody. And I know you're thinking, I have so much going on. I can't think about how am I going to help another person. But hear the true thing behind all that. In order to be well, you have to create the scene to be well for somebody else. When you take the spotlight off your own struggling and your own suffering and put a bright light on somebody else and help them, you will see how God sent Gideon to take care of your business for you, to prayer you up, to hold you up, to put $10,000 in your hand, to pay your mortgage, to pay your car note, to put food in your cupboards, to bring health to your body. Free. It will cost you nothing. To be sweet, to be kind, to look at somebody and say, you're struggling with something. What can I pray about for you? Or to just pass somebody and put a bills in them hand. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes I'm hungry. I walk into a bank one time in New Kingston and just walk up to a lady and slide her some money. And she's like, I'm like, Holy Spirit, tell me to do it. Don't ask me. I just follow instructions.
And sometimes that looks like just sharing what has happened to you so somebody else can know is not the one.
Yes. If what I went through, if Denise Hunt, because Jamaicans don't call me Denise or Miss Hunt, Denise Hunt can go through somebody beating on her. From running from adult men who wanted to abuse my body at 6 and at 7 and at 12 and at 11 and at 10. If I can do that, and if I can stand before you and say to you, once you open your mouth and say, okay, I've gone through that, then we're in a good spot. Not I am going through this, because if you're I am-ing, you're in it. What you want to do is go through it, round it, underneath it, and I promise you can do it. Because the minute you open your mouth and say, this is happening to me and I don't want it, I promise you the help will come. The help will come. You literally don't have to feel sorry for yourself or feel that you are less than. I am begging you to open your mouth and say, I'm being abused, or I'm poor, or I'm not a good parent, or I'm depressed, or I'm ashamed of this.
I need help.
You don't even have to say, I need help. All you have to do is say what the wrong thing is, what the disease is.
And the help will come
100% of the time. And I want one final thing to say. You have to know that you deserve it. You have to feel that you are deserving of it. You have to know you are entitled to it because there's breath coming out of you. And how dare you give up? When you're so beautiful, like you have so much inside of you, how dare you give up? Don't give up. You deserve it. Right. It's yours.
We gotta go.
Gosh.
My gosh. Powerful enough.
We gotta go.
Thank you for coming on our invitation.
Thank you, Simone, for following the unction that says, I am going to stand out of my story because somebody else is going through or will be going through. And I'm gonna dig deep into others so that they will share their story. Thank you for doing that, because you could have stood down in a radio, you could have stood down in a corporate and not do it. And then where would all the help be? If it's whose job? It's your job, and you did it. So yay. Yay, you, Sim. Yay, you, Sim.
Yay, you, Den.
Amen.
Celebrate you, Milo. All right, let's go. The program overrun. And it's Denny's for... Go back for your plane and go on back afar. Mm-hmm. All right, here we go, folks. Affirmation time. Let's lead the show. Final time for this season. Owning your story is a powerful thing. And sharing your story is even more so. So, we're all our stories, the sum total of our experiences. And as with any other story, there are good parts, really bad parts, and some parts we don't even remember or want to remember that have had an impact on who we are today. But that's the important part, everybody. It's today. You are not your yesterdays any more than you are your tomorrows. And what about what you did yesterday? It doesn't have to derail your today or destroy your tomorrow, but you have to own it, be proud of it, all of it. And if you're so inclined or so led, share it, because it can help someone else know that even though they may not know you, they know for a fact that they are not alone, because you've been to where they are and you are still here. That will give somebody hope to fight another day. So tonight we are all affirming, I am not yesterday's failure. I am tomorrow's success. And that is our soul food and our show for this evening and for this season. Thank you guys for watching. I can't believe we're 13 episodes in already. I want to thank you for staying with us for the great ride that season 6 has been. We will see you. We will see you in 2023. For season 7. Until then, every blessing, everybody, and please remember to count your blessings. God bless. Take care.